All right. So today is this week is the week of St. John Climacus, and today we're gonna, as I mentioned, today we're gonna talk about St. John Climacus and St. Mary of Egypt because that way we'll have time next Tuesday to talk about Holy Week and Pascha. So without further ado, let us, and of course, I forgot my phone today. I was going to do the hymns. Actually, we can do the hymn for St. John Climacus because it's in this book. So we'll just have to do that for our prayer. So please rise. Actually, what we can do, let's not be lazy. Saint Anthony Music Project. See. Let's pull up. Let's see. I can find Saint Mary of Egypt here. The Holy Assumption Parish, OCA Parish, downtown Canton, has a piece of her shirt at her parish. When you enter into the parish, right in the narthex on the left is this huge icon of Saint Mary of Egypt, and by her shin or her knee, one of these two, there's a little reliquary attached to the icon, and it's a white piece of her shirt. So they have that relic there, FYI. So Saturday nights they have Vespers, so feel free to go this coming Saturday for Vespers at 5 p.m. and venerate Saint Mary. All right, so first we will begin here with the Politikion for St. John Climacus, and then we'll go and do the Politikion for St. Mary of Egypt. All right. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. Thou didst scale the mount of godly virtue to raise up a great and sacred ladder on the which we ascend from this fallen state. And leaving passions beneath, we rise step by step unto the vision of God and the life on high. Hence, O righteous Father John, as our God-appointed guide, entreat the Lord to grant great mercy unto us. And now for the Apotheke of St. Mary of Egypt. Now, yeah. Indeed, the image was preserved with exactness, O Mother, for taking up thy cross, thou didst follow Christ, and by thy deeds thou didst teach us to overlook the flesh, for it passeth away. But to attend to the soul, since it is immortal. Wherefore, O righteous Mary, thy spirit rejoiceth with the angels. Amen.
Amen. Is that the notation you read?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's Byzantine notation.
What?
My professor at seminary told us that the oldest music notation in the world. Or that, let me put it this way, Byzantine notation came directly from the oldest music notation. So it's in other words, Byzantine notation is one of the oldest as well. All right. So let us begin with Saint John Climacus. So St. John Climacus is celebrated on every year on the fourth Sunday of Great Lent. And I believe he has another separate feast day, if I'm not mistaken. I can't remember exactly now. But every year on the fourth Sunday of Great Lent. As you're gonna hear tonight in a few videos, he lived in the sixth century. And he was the abbot at the St. Catherine's Monastery in Sinai. This monastery is still in existence to this day. It's at the base of Mount Sinai where Moses received the tablets of the Ten Commandments from God. And by the way, there is an icon exhibit in Cleveland coming up. The Metropolitan of that area of Sinai is bringing many of these icons from that famous monastery to Cleveland. So feel free to check that out. He's called Climacus because Climacus in Greek, Climacos, means a ladder or to ascend a ladder. And the reason why he's called that is because he wrote this book, The Ladder of Divine Ascent. And this book, he basically writes about how we can be freed of the passions and how to acquire the divine virtues in their place. So we need to do both. We need to get rid of the passions and also acquire the virtues. And he gives very specific instructions of how to do this, very practically. He shares many stories of exemplary ascetics who practice many of these virtues, and he almost writes very poetically. It's a very beautiful text. And so, as we've been talking about for the last 4 weeks, is the connection, the interconnection between each of these weeks of Great Lent. And so, Saint John is connected to last week's Sunday, which was the Sunday of the Cross. He is connected to that. He bridges transitions beautifully from last week because he shows us very practically, very in a very simple manner, how we ourselves can deny ourselves, pick up our cross, and follow Christ. And so ultimately the great goal, the ultimate goal of repentance, of carrying our cross, practicing the virtues, getting rid of the passions, is of course seeing God, right? Seeing God. Christ says the pure in heart will see God. And this is the great height that we're trying to ascend toward. And that's exactly what you see in the icon of the ladder of divine ascent. Monks ascending this ladder, trying to acquire the virtues, get rid of their bad passions, and rise up to the vision of God himself. And historical note, this text was written for monks, but the beauty of it is that the advice, generally speaking, by and large, is also applicable to us who live in the world. So it's a text for everyone. And so, with that said, let us now begin, or let us shift gears and watch this nice little video.
What if you could do SEO smarter and faster? With Wix, you can edit your meta tags page by page or all in one go.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, on the fourth Sunday of Lent, we commemorate Saint John of the Ladder. Saint John Climacus is honored by the Church as a great ascetic and as the author of a remarkable work entitled The Ladder of Divine Ascent, and therefore he has been named Climacus, or of the Ladder. There has been very little information preserved about his origin. Tradition tells us that he was born in around the year 570 and was the son of Saints Xenophon and Maria, who are commemorated on January the 26th and February the 28th. Saint John came to the monastery on Mount Sinai at the age 16. Abba Martyrius became his spiritual father and mentor. After 4 years of living on Mount Sinai, John was tonsured a monk. One of the fathers present at his tonsure foretold that John would become a great luminary of Christ's church. Saint John labored in asceticism for 19 years in obedience to his spiritual father. After the death of Abba Martyrius, Saint John chose the life of reclusion, departing to a desert place called Thola, where he lived 40 years in silence, fasting, prayer, and repentant tears. It is not by chance that Saint John speaks so much of repentant tears in the latter. As fire burns and destroys dead wood, so do pure tears cleanse all impurity, both inwardly and outwardly. His prayer was strong and effective. This can be seen in the following example of the great ascetic's life. Saint John had a disciple, Monk Moses. One day, Saint John sent his disciple to spread soil on the garden beds. As he was fulfilling his obedience, the monk Moses became weary from the fierce summer heat and reclined under the shade of a large cliff. Saint John was in his cell at that moment, resting a bit after his labor of prayer. Suddenly, a man of venerable countenance appeared and woke the ascetic, reproving him. "John, why are you resting peacefully here while Moses is in danger?" Saint John immediately arose and began praying for his disciple. When Moses returned that evening, the saint asked him if anything had happened to him that day. The monk answered, "No, but I was in serious danger. A large rock broke off from a cliff under which I had fallen asleep at midday and nearly crushed me. Fortunately, I was having a dream in which you were calling me, and I jumped up and ran. At that moment, a huge rock fell with a crash upon the very place where I was." It is known from St. John's life that he ate what was allowed by the rule of fasting, but within measure. He did not go without sleep at night, although he never slept more than was needed to support his strength for ceaseless vigilance, and so as not to negatively affect his mind. "I did not fast beyond measure," he said of himself, "and I did not conduct intensified night vigil, nor did I sleep on the ground. But I humbled myself, and the Lord speedily saved me." The following example of St. John's humility is notable. Gifted with a strong, sharp mind that was made wise by deep spiritual experience, he taught everyone who came to him and guided them to salvation. But when certain others, out of jealousy, accused him of loquaciousness, which they said sprung from vainglory, St. John took a vow of silence in order not to tempt anyone, and remained thus for a year. His enviers admitted their error and begged the ascetic not to deprive them of his beneficial instruction. To hide his ascetic labors from people, St. John would sometimes depart to a solitary cave. But fame of his holiness spread far beyond his enclosure, and people from all walks of life would come to seek him, seeking a word of edification and salvation. When he was 75 years old, after 40 years of ascetic labors in solitude, the saint was chosen to be abbot of Sinai. Saint John Climacus ruled the holy monastery for 4 years. The Lord granted the saint many gifts of grace toward the end of his life, including clairvoyance and miracle working. During St. John's abbacy, another St. John, abbot of Rathu Monastery, commemorated on the Saturday of Cheese Fair Week, asked him to write the famous Ladder, Instructions for the Ascent to Spiritual Perfection. Knowing of the saint's wisdom and spiritual gifts, the abbot Rathu asked on behalf of all the monks of this monastery for true instruction for those who seek unwaveringly and a kind of steadfast ladder that will take those who desire it to the heavenly gates. Saint John, who had a humble opinion of himself, first balked at the task, but then set about writing the treatise out of obedience to the request of the Rathu monks. He thus called the work the Ladder, explaining his choice, "I have built a ladder of ascent from earth to holiness. In honor of the 30 years of the Lord, I have built a ladder of 30 steps, which, if we climb it to the age of the Lord, we will be righteous and safe from falls." The aim of this treatise was to teach us that the attainment of salvation requires difficult self-denial and intense ascetical labor. The latter first suggests the cleansing of sinful impurity, the uprooting of the vices and passions of the old man. Second, it shows the restoration of God's image in man. Although the book was written for monks, any Christian who lives in the world will find it a reliable guide on the ascent to God. Pillars of spiritual life, such as St. Theodore the Studite, St. Sergius of Radonezh, and St. Joseph of Volokolamsk, and others continually referred to the latter as the best book for soul-saving instruction. The content of one of the steps of the latter, number 22, discusses the labor of uprooting vainglory. St. John.
All right, and we'll stop right there. All right. So let us now dig into this text. This text that you have in front of you is a very simplified commentary and explanation of St. John's book. And he offers little snippet commentaries on certain quotes from the latter of these steps. And so let us go ahead and get into this. The first step we're going to look at tonight, actually the only step we're going to look at tonight, is on anger, actually, and meekness. So this is, you can open up the text in front of you, and this is step 8 of the ladder. All right. So how about we have someone here read, we'll go section by section, or I'll stop you when I want to switch readers, but if you'd like to read, feel free to do so. And if not, just pass it to the next person. So we'll start with George. Before you start, forgive me, let me open up the text here so that the people who are going to watch will be able to also follow along.
Salvus, wouldn't we hear that this book is, in a sense, like the philokalia, that's ascetical instruction?
Yeah, I think so. I would say that it focuses, the Philokalia focuses, the writers from the Philokalia focus more on like the Jesus prayer. Sometimes they talk about the particular passions and virtues, but mostly it's about hesychasm and the Jesus prayer. This text is more on practical like virtues and passions. But it's definitely up there on par, I think, spiritually speaking. All right, let's go ahead.
We tend to think of meekness as a personality trait. When we hear the word meek, we usually think of someone softly spoken, easily pushed around, someone who never raises his voice, maybe even someone who is weak. But meekness is not the same as weakness, nor is it a particular kind of personality. It is a virtue, and like all virtues, I cannot be judged by externals. Our Lord described himself as meek, yet he smashed up the markets outside the temple in Jerusalem. He denounced the Pharisees, scribes, and Sadducees as hypocrites, and a broad of vipers, and he told them they were going to hell. He frequently rebuked his apostles and admonished them, the Israelites, for their faithlessness. He was no pushover until he voluntarily gave himself up in humiliation, violence, and death, even though as God he had the power and indeed the right to destroy his oppressors on the spot. As Christians, we are called to take up Christ's yoke and imitate his meekness. This does not mean we are called to be doormats. Instead, it means we are to endure wrongs humbly and patiently, and to let go of our anger, which is the fruit of pride.
All right. Would you like to read? Cody, go ahead.
Lost temper and the passion of anger. There's still weakness and anger. St. John astutely notes there is a difference between the passion of anger and loss of temper.
The latter is not always a sin, and can sometimes be helpful both to the one who expresses his anger and the one on the receiving end of it. But anger that is concealed, bottled up, and allowed to fester is like a poison that runs through one's entire body, lingering in the veins and darkening the intellect, or noose. I have seen people delivered from passion by the very fact that they had flared up and then poured out their long-stored grievance, and, in addition, they got from their offender either some reparation or some explanation for what had caused the long-standing grievance. On the other hand, I have seen men who appeared to be displaying stolid patience, but who, in reality, were silently harboring resentment within themselves. These, it seems to me, were much more to be pitied than the men prone to explosions of temper. St. John Climacus echoes the words of that other great tutor of monastic life and Christian spirituality, St. John Cassian. If we take St. Paul literally, then we are not allowed to cling to our anger for even a day. I would like to make a comment, however, that many people are so embittered and furious when they are in a state of anger, that they not only cling to their anger for a day, but drag it on for weeks. I am at a loss for words to explain those who do not even vent their anger in speech, but erect a barrier of sullen silence around them and distill the bitter poison of their hearts until it finally destroys them. They could not have understood how important it is to avoid anger, not merely externally, but even in our thoughts, because it darkens our intellect with bitterness, and it cuts us off from the radiance of spiritual understanding and discernment by depriving it of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Malice thrives in the deceptively meek and silent. We so often judge meekness and patience by externals. I have seen people remain calm in the face of abusiveness, and after I expressed my admiration for their patience, they confessed the boiling rage that was within them, which in many cases remained with them for days, weeks, months, or even years to come. St. John Climacus describes similar cases he himself witnessed even in the skeets of a monastery. Once, while engaged on some task, I happened to be sitting outside a monastery and near the cells of those in solitude. I could overhear them raging alone in their cells and in their bitter fury, leaping about like caged partridges, leaping at the face of their offender as if he were actually there. My humble advice to them was to abandon solitary living in case they turn from human beings into devils. Again, this is reminiscent of St. John Cassian, who warns us that solitude is no remedy for anger. When we are angry with others, we should not seek solitude on the grounds that there are, at least, no one will provoke us to anger, and that in solitude the virtue of long-suffering can easily be acquired. Our desire to leave our brethren is because of our pride, and because we do not wish to blame ourselves and ascribe to our own laxity the cause of our unruliness. So long as we assign the causes for our weaknesses to others, we cannot attain perfection in long-suffering. Self-reform and peace are not achieved through the patience which others show us, but through our own long-suffering towards our neighbor. When we try to escape the struggle for long-suffering by retreating into solitude, those unhealed passions we take there with us are merely hidden, not erased. For unless our passions are first purged, solitude and withdrawal from the world not only foster them, but also keep them concealed, no longer allowing us to perceive what passion it is that enslaves us. On the contrary, they impose on us an illusion of virtue and persuade us to believe that we have achieved long-suffering and humility, because there is no one present to provoke and test us. Our passions grow fiercer when left idle through lack of contact with other people. We should always bear in mind our own ignorance of the time of our death, keeping ourselves from anger and recognizing that neither self-restraint nor the renunciation of all material things, nor fasting and vigils, are of any benefit if we are found guilty at the last judgment, because we are the slaves of anger and hatred.
Let me see here. Okay, let me offer a quick word on that. So this really struck me when I read up to this part, especially. So even if we don't externally show our anger, we can still hold on to anger within ourselves. And we can like be sitting there angry with someone, but not express it verbally out loud externally, and yet be sitting there and yet fuming with rage inside of ourselves and be thinking all these horrible things about this person, and like expressing that anger internally within ourselves, kind of keeping it to ourselves. And so I just, for me personally, I thought that was like really important to note that like we have to get rid of both, right? We have to try to refrain from, you know, getting wrongfully angry, both externally and internally. And obviously that takes it takes a struggle, it takes a battle. And that's another thing, is that sometimes we might think, oh, okay, well, I'll just avoid people so that way I don't get angry, right? But that's like saying, I'm not going to go to the gym and work out, right? So like, in other words, just as like, if you want to get strong and healthy, you have to go to the gym, you have to work out, you have to push through the pain and the suffering, and then you'll grow, right? Well, in the same way is that when we're encountering temptations, that's actually a beautiful opportunity given to us to actually grow in virtue. So if you don't have temptations, you can't grow in virtue. And if you can't grow in virtue, then you can't be saved, which is why some of the saints say, paradoxically, thank God for temptations, because temptations are challenges, good challenges, opportunities for us to actually practice virtue. So if you decide to retreat, rather, from the battle, from the struggle, and try to avoid people so that you don't fall into temptation of anger, well, that's like saying, I'm not going to go to the gym, or I'm not going to go and fight in a battle, right? You've already lost. You've already lost. St. Joseph the Hesychast talks about this in his, there's a nice little section there in his book. I'll send it to you guys, because someone did a really nice design, copy and pasted this little conversation he was having with Elder Friend, and put it into a nice document. And something to the effect of like, why so many temptations? And there was a monk who went to St. Joseph or another elder and said, Elder, I've had no temptations today. I must be really holy, right? And he said, oh, you've already lost the war. You know, you've lost the war. Like, and it's a really nice text. He explains this much more simply than I could. And basically just pointing out that you have to engage in the battle. You have to enter into it and battle your demons, right? Otherwise you can't grow as Christians. So I thought that was just two really, really interesting and very important principles that St. John mentioned there. So, all right, Cody, yeah.
Well, that would be with anger, like you have anger with another person. What about like when you're angry with yourself?
Mm.
How would you possibly, like, how would that be that?
I guess it can be good and bad. So like the saints talk about the need for us to practice self-reproach, self-criticism. Like for instance, if I cussed with my mouth today, hypothetically, and if I realize that, then I should reproach myself and say, oh, I'm so sinful. I need to do better. I should have been more careful, right? And when you reproach yourself, then you acquire humility. You deepen your humility, and God answers to your humility, right? What does Christ say in the gospel? God resists the proud, but he gives his grace to the humble. So self-reproach is very good in the spiritual life, and we should do that. Each time we fall into a sin, temptation, we should reproach ourselves. But if we take it too far, if we get excessively angry with us, with ourselves, then you can fall into despair. So I think we have to have a healthy balance of humility, self-reproach, self-criticism, judging yourself, knowing yourself, examining yourself on a daily basis. But on the other hand, also hoping in the mercy of God and seeking God's mercy and forgiveness. So you have to, it's like a tightrope walk, have to have a healthy balance.
How do we deal with anger at stupid bureaucrats and leaders in the law? What's the staple in it's like, I do feel like, come on, people, get some common sense.
Well, Christ says, in the book of Psalms, and you're going to see this in a second, I think, in the book of Psalm, I think it's chapter 4 or 41, it says, be angry, but do not sin. Christ says, do not judge, but in another place he says, judge righteously. So there's good judgment and bad judgment. There's good anger and there's bad anger. So I think, for example, if we are zealous, for instance, Christ got angry, right? He went into the temple and he found that the Jews turned it into a marketplace. And he got angry and he tossed the tables and literally got so angry that he literally whipped the people out of the temple. So that was a moment of righteous anger where we can practice righteous anger, where we are angry for justified reasons for things that are good, right? Moments of justice, moments of being angry when holy things are mistreated, for instance. But case by case, I think we have to also be careful. And that's why we need a spiritual father to kind of guide us with telling us where we should practice righteous anger and where we might be a little bit off a little bit. So, yeah. Any other questions, comments? Moving on? All right, let's move on. Cody, you want to continue there?
In a similar vein.
Nice and loud, please.
In a similar vein, St. John Climacus reminds us to be careful not to confuse having no cause to get angry with not suffering from the passion of anger. Let us not forget, my friends, that evil demons sometimes leave us unexpectedly, with the result that we may become careless about these strong passions within us, thinking them to be of no consequence, and become, therefore, incurably ill. At the risk of attaching modern ideas or terminology to the latter, it seems to me that St. John is warning us against bottling up our anger. It is far better to lose one's temper and let it out, rather than to appear forbearing, patient, and humble, all the while fuming with rage inside. Best of all, of course, is neither to lose our temper nor to allow anger to fester. A sign of utter meekness is to have a heart that is peacefully and lovingly disposed towards someone who has been offensive. And a sure proof of a hot temper is that a man, even when he is alone, should with word and gesture continue to rage and fulminate against some absent person who has given offense. Anger is an indication of concealed hatred, of grievance nursed. Pride is the root of anger. The passion of anger is not merely a tendency to lose one's temper, rather it is a spiritual disease that is not always apparent. St. John connects anger with pride and conceit, and therefore sees humility as its cure. Freedom from anger is an endless wish for dishonor, whereas among the vainglorious, there is a limitless thirst for praise. Freedom from anger is a triumph over one's nature. It is the ability to be impervious to insults and comes by hard work and the sweat of one's brow. How is pride the root of anger? St. John is not speaking of righteous indignation, anger at sin, but of anger that arises from wounded pride. While people's rudeness or nastiness may seem a just cause to be angry, the passion of anger often has nothing to do with being stirred against sin. Even when someone makes a fair and perceptive criticism with the intention of helping us, anger is sometimes roused within us. Sometimes, either inwardly or outwardly, we lash out at our critic because we fail to see the truth that is being pointed out to us. But only when we are humble are we able to see things as they really are. Moreover, we think ourselves superior to our critics, so that even if we do admit the criticism is correct, our reaction is, who are you to criticize me? The more prideful we are, the more incorrigible we become, for we begin to see ourselves as superior to everyone. Though, of course, we are too proud even to admit we see ourselves that way. Thus, St. John regards anger as a complete contradiction to a life of humility and repentance. Nothing is so out of place in a repentant person as an unholy spirit. For conversion requires great humility and anger is an indication of all kinds of presuppositions. Humility remedies anger because it remedies pride. The more true our repentance, the less wounded we are by anger.
All right, so trying to think. Let's see here. There was something that jumped out at me. This is when people criticize us, when people say something, whether it was constructive criticism or something just nasty and rude, in many of the lives of the saints, for example, Elder Ephrem, for example, there was one of the monks who was walking with him, and this monk wanted to test to see how much humility Elder Ephrem had. So as they were walking, Elder Ephrem took out the key to his room, but tried to put it into the keyhole, but had the key upside down. So the monk, at the moment he knew, oh, this will be a good chance for me to see how much humility he has. So he made a comment. He kind of criticized Elder Ephrem. He goes, Elder, you're so upside down. And instead of Elder Ephrem getting upset and saying, how dare you criticize me? Don't you know that I'm your elder? Like, you should be respectful. Elder Ephrem responded saying, yes, yes, I am so upside down. God forgive me. You know, Lord have mercy. And so that shows how any time that we have an opportunity for someone to criticize us, we should take that in. We should try to, as best as possible, to take that in and accept it, right? And when you accept it without complaining or without lashing out in response, then you're developing humility. And so this is, again, opportunities for us to grow in the virtues. And the more that we develop the virtues, simultaneously, the passions are becoming less and less prevalent within our heart. So this is some extra commentary. All right, Garrett, would you like to do the next section?
Mm-hmm. Overcoming anger is by no means easy, and the latter provides us with three stages of progress on the path of mastering this passion. The first step toward freedom from anger is to keep the lips silent when the heart is stirred. If we are able to keep our mouth shut, even when we are upset, we are at least making a beginning of not giving into anger. Despite what St. John said about bottling up anger being far worse than losing one's temper, it is also worth remembering that letting our anger out can often be very harmful to those around us. If we strive to refrain from acting or speaking in anger for the sake of others, rather than for admiration and praise, then we are acting with good intentions, and we are at least learning to keep anger from dominating one of our faculty of speech. The next, to keep thoughts silent when the soul is upset. The next step is to silence our thoughts and not just our lips. We must learn not to dwell on an offense or to think bad things of those who have wronged or wounded us. Anger dwelled upon becomes a grudge, a refusal to forgive and forget, a denial of humility. While we may speak ill of others, our thoughts can be full of cursing and arrogant condemnation. If those thoughts come from the heart, intentional thoughts that emanate from the sickness of our soul, rather than fleeting thoughts that enter our mind as temptations, they condemn us before God no less than if we uttered those thoughts aloud. When angered, we must learn to let the anger go, as St. Paul writes, do not let the sun go down on your wrath. The last to be calm when unclean winds are blowing. The final step is not to take offense at insults or be grieved by injuries. How few ever truly master anger. But to master anger does not mean to become incapable of it. On this point, let us be absolutely clear. Even our Lord became angry when he saw people turning the temple of God into a marketplace, and he became furious with the hypocrisy of the religious elite. If it is indeed true that Christ, in his humanity, is like us in every respect except sin, then we cannot say that all anger is sinful. As the psalmist said, be angry and do not sin. Of course, we must sometimes be careful when we speak of Jesus as an example, or as God,
he had a right to do and say something no one else has the right to do or say. But this makes the example of profound humility we see in his passion all the more powerful and relevant to us. For he expressed no anger when he himself was the victim of sin, although no one but Christ could ever claim to be undeserving of disrespect and suffering. Our ultimate example is the King of Glory, abused and crucified in humility and love.
All right. So, yeah, it's really beautiful to think about, like, Christ was murdered by his own creation. And yet he willingly died and he willingly did it all for us, right? Like, he never took vengeance on his enemies. And instead, he actually loved them and forgave them and prayed for them. And so Christ is a beautiful example for us. You know, basically, we can think to ourselves in the moment of anger, when we're tempted with anger, we can think to ourselves, not even Christ got angry with those who mistreated him. Who am I? You know, I'm no better than Christ. Who am I to get angry with those who offend me? Shouldn't I be following Christ's example? So this is another thing that we can reflect on as a way to overcome that temptation. All right. Here on this section, I'll just summarize it so we can quickly get to St. Mary of Egypt. Anger, when we don't take care of anger, other passions will pop up. Many times they're interconnected with other passions, like lust and gluttony. And a method of overcoming anger is to practice gratitude and praising God. So in a moment when we're tempted with anger, to just say, glory to God, and may it be blessed. So that way we don't go down the rabbit hole of that passion and open ourselves up to other passions. Another thing, I'll summarize the next one. Beautifully, Saint John says that another way you can overcome anger is by singing. And in particular, singing church hymns. This is a nice way to overcome that urge to get angry and to instead take delight in the beauty of the church hymns. The thing about the church hymns is that they're prayers. So they're filled with the grace of God. And when we sing, we're filling ourselves up with God's grace. And so this is how that we can overcome that temptation of anger. Let me see here. He also talks about practicing patience. And when correcting other people, trying to do it with peace, patience, gentleness, kindness, and love, rather than with anger. Sometimes we have to be stern with our words, but even that can become a moment where we are tripping down a rabbit hole to anger. So we have to be careful with that. I'll allow you guys to read the rest of this on your own, but I want to get to St. Mary of Egypt now. And he also talks about humility as well. So make sure you find the time to read it. It's a phenomenal text. I highly recommend this book. Very good. I know that we have this book at our Holy Trinity bookstore. So feel free to check that out. And if you want to read more about it, you can come up here and check it out. But now we're going to turn to St. Mary of Egypt.
Repentance is more. Repentance is more than just a decision to forgo the transgression of some moral law or code of conduct. It is a movement, a turning away from sin and death, and a turning toward life in communion with God and others. It is cooperation with God's grace, whereby we recognize our fallen nature and dependence upon Him. Such repentance, such turning away from self-sufficiency, tears down the barrier that separates us from God and helps us to reconnect with our Creator, who through His love and grace can transform our very mode of existence. Throughout the year, the Church holds before us examples of such repentance and transformation, such as during Great Lent, when we are reminded of the life of Saint Mary of Egypt, an enduring example of repentance and a reflection upon the radical change that can occur in a human being through the grace, love, and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. A young woman is harshly shoved and knocked around. She pushes back, making her way through the crowd. Just then, she sees a large group preparing to go on pilgrimage to Jerusalem for the exaltation of the Holy Cross of Christ. She sensed ample opportunity to satisfy her lustful appetite. Her pursuit of men had begun at the age of 12, when she ran away from her parents' humble village and went to live in the big city. What early patterns, what complexes drove her thirst for pleasure are unknown, but after 17 years of prolonged habit, it had become unquenchable. With no money for passage, Mary offered her body as payment, for although she never accepted money from the men she slept with, so as to not reduce her appeal to them, nor reduce her own pleasure, she well knew the weakness of the flesh and could count on even outwardly pious men to succumb to her entreaties. Mary spent the entire journey seducing and enticing others for her own amusement, and when they reached Jerusalem, she spent the days leading up to the feast with any man willing to help her fulfill the yearnings of her flesh. Even as Mary made her way to the church on the day of the feast, she still sought out pleasure with anyone willing. When she arrived at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, she waited impatiently with others in line. When she finally attempted to enter through the great doors, an invisible force blocked her way and then forced her back. Surprised at first, this rebuff only strengthened her will to enter. She stepped forward again, only to be met with what felt like an invisible stone wall. Even though the doors were wide open and others were entering, she then bore her full weight against this unseen and immovable force. But again, she failed to enter. Mary stood back and collected her strength. She then approached again with the full force of her body a third time, certain that she would gain entry into the church. She tried to propel herself through the huge doors as her body burned with every shred of remaining strength. But the unseen force allowed her no entry. Exhausted, Mary finally gave up and sat dejected in the church's courtyard. Just then, an icon on the side of the building caught her eye. It was a depiction of the Virgin Mary, the Theotokos, the Mother of God. As Mary of Egypt drew closer, she sensed the purity of the All-Holy Lady in a manner beyond reason and understanding. A deep shame overcame her, and she wept, for she saw in the Virgin Mary a person who found freedom from surrendering her own will to God. The Virgin Mary longed for God, and in turn became more spacious than the heavens, illumined with the grace of the Holy Spirit. While Mary of Egypt had freely given herself in slavery to the passions and found only a heart filled with darkness, Mary realized that she did not deserve to enter the church and stand in front of the holy and precious cross of Christ. A searing pain filled her heart as she faced, as in a mirror, the memories of her wanton youth, her selfish ways, and her complete and abject distance from the loving God who created her. She prostrated herself before the icon as her dark heart broke open to memories of sins, of lewdness, of lust, the complete horror of seeing her true self and realizing her own self-centeredness. She confessed it all to the Theotokos. Mary realized then that only God could soothe the pain and fill the emptiness of her heart, and that it was she alone who had blocked the love and grace of God through her own free will. She then made a vow to the Theotokos that if she would be permitted to enter the church and venerate the Holy Cross, she would spend the rest of her life in complete obedience to the Mother of God. She would go wherever the Most Glorious Lady guided her in order to work out her salvation. It was the beginning of Great Lent, and as was the custom in those days, monastics would spend the season alone in the wilderness, so as to not see how others fasted, and thus fall into the sins of pride or judgment. Father Zosimus was such a monk, carrying only a scant amount of food and water, and only one extra tattered garment into the desert. He was well known among his peers as a holy man of great wisdom and discernment, someone with true spiritual gifts. Monastics from all over the surrounding monasteries had been coming to him for years for spiritual counsel. Now, as Father Zosimus journeyed forward into the blistering heat, he beseeched God for an encounter with someone from whom he could benefit spiritually. A few days later, Father Zosimus sojourned along the banks of the Jordan River. Suddenly, something caught his eye amidst the shimmering heat. He spotted a dark, angular form in the distance. Thinking that this might be a demon, he immediately made the sign of the cross and then continued forward as he perceived no sense of evil or hatred surrounding him. Yet, as he drew closer to the shape, the farther it moved away. It occurred to Zosimus that this might be a humble, grace-filled ascetic from whom he could receive a blessing. This could be God's answer to his prayer. But perhaps the hermit was exceedingly humble and was avoiding Zosimus out of attempts to draw attention away from himself. The thought then occurred to Zosimus that this might be his one chance to learn from a holy and unknown ascetic. And so, despite the oppressive heat, his own weariness, and advanced age, he continued forward. But the figure was too fast. Finally, they reached a dry stream bed, and Zosimus cried out sorrowfully, "Why are you running away from this old and sinful man? O servant of the true God, wait up for me, whoever you are, in the name of God, for whose sake you dwell in the desert, unworthy as I am. Stop and give this old man your blessing and benediction, for God never abhors anyone." The figure on the other side of the stream bed relented and said,
"Father Zosimus, forgive me in the name of the Lord. I cannot turn toward you and be seen face to face. For as you see, I am a woman, and I am naked, and I am ashamed to have my body uncovered. But if you are really willing to grant one favor to a sinful woman, throw me the garment you are wearing, so that with it I may turn toward you and receive your blessing."
Astonished that she knew his name, he tossed her his cloak, and she covered herself. Turning toward him, she queried,
"Why, Father Zosimus, did you decide to look at a sinful woman? What did you wish to learn from me or see that you did not hesitate to put yourself to such trouble?"
At this time, Zosimus was certain that this woman was a partaker of divine grace. He knelt before her to receive her blessing. She knelt before him for his blessing, and neither rose for a long time. Each felt that they were unworthy to impart a blessing on the other. But finally, the woman rebuked him, saying,
"Father Zosimus, it is fitting for you to give a blessing in prayer, for you have been honored with the rank of priest, and you have served at the holy altar for many years, and have often performed the sacrament of the holy gifts.
shocked that she knew not only his name, but also that he was a priest, Zosimus realized that he was in the presence of a holy woman. He refused to get up until she imparted her blessing, and reluctantly prayed for them both. Then, they entered into conversation, and Zosimus begged her to tell him about her life, so that he could gain spiritual wisdom from her experiences. Her humble reply and honest simplicity touched his heart.
I am ashamed, my father, to describe for you my sinful actions. Forgive me in the name of the Lord. But since you have seen my bare body, I shall lay bare to you also my deeds, so that you may know with what great shame and humiliation my soul is filled. But before I do so, I ask you to swear that you will not stop praying for me, that I may find mercy in the hour of judgment.
Zosimus knew that it was often the most sinful people who ended up repenting with the greatest dedication and fervor. Even so, he had not expected to hear that this wizened, emaciated old woman had once been capable of such lustful actions. He listened in awe as she described her life of sin, her miraculous prevention from entering the church, her heart-piercing experience of confession to the Theotokos, and her repentance. She often referenced scripture in their conversation while relating her story, so he asked her when she had started studying the holy texts. He was amazed to hear that she had never read any, and that she hadn't even attended church for 47 years. All she knew, she had been taught by the Mother of God in the desert. She proceeded to confess to him that the first 17 years that she spent in the desert had been a true torment. She had wrestled painfully with her past wantonness and the desire to return to her previous life. After that, she began to know peace, being aided by the Theotokos, and being granted the grace to see God's uncreated light. She made him vow not to tell anyone of her story until she had died, and asked Zosimus to meet her again on Holy Thursday the next year. She wanted to receive Holy Communion from Zosimus, but warned him not to come any sooner than the following Holy Thursday, as something bad would befall him. Sure enough, when he returned to the monastery, Zosimus kept silent about what he had experienced. As she predicted, toward the end of the following Great Lent, he did indeed become ill with a fever, but he recovered in time to search for the hermit in the desert on Holy Thursday. Standing in the same spot where they had met the previous year, with the holy gifts in his hands, he was greatly disappointed because she wasn't there. So he prayed that he would be granted another encounter with this grace-filled ascetic. Soon after, she appeared on the opposite bank of the river. She made the sign of the cross over the water and walked across the river to his side of the riverbank. Stunned, Zosimus tried to bow to her. The woman protested, saying that since he had the holy gifts in his hands, she should be the one bowing to him. He recited the creed and the Lord's Prayer, and offered her the holy gifts. After receiving Holy Communion from him, and with tears in her eyes, she proclaimed,
"Lord, now let your servant depart in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation."
Then she asked Zosimus to meet her again the following year, at the same place. Before departing, Father Zosimus touched her feet and requested her blessing and her prayers for the church. A year later, Father Zosimus returned to the desert on Holy Thursday. The blessed ascetic's body lay dead on the unyielding sand, facing east with her hands folded. He realized, with a pang of regret, that he hadn't even known her name. He did not know how she should be buried. But then, he noticed writing in the sand near her head.
"Father Zosimus, bury the body of the humbled Mary in this place. Return dust to dust, and pray always to the Lord for me. I died in the month of Pharmuthi, according to the Egyptians, on that very night of the Passion of our Savior, after I received the Holy Last Supper.
Zosimus understood that Mary had died on the same night after she received Holy Communion from him the previous year, and he sorrowfully began to dig her grave. But the earth was dry and packed hard. Suddenly, a huge lion appeared next to Mary's body, and it was licking her feet. Moved by the scene, Zosimus said to the lion, "Do what is necessary with your claws, so that we may return to the earth the body of the blessed woman." The lion's powerful claws rent the sand while Zosimus prayed over Mary and covered her with the tattered cloak he'd given her when they first met. After Mary's burial, Zosimus and the lion departed. Back at the monastery, Zosimus related the story of Mary's wisdom and holiness, where all marveled and gave glory to God. Mary's story continued to be told in the surrounding Christian communities, even after Zosimus reposed at the age of 100. Today, St. Mary is remembered twice a year on the Orthodox liturgical calendar, on April 1st, and also on the fifth Sunday of Great Lent. Through repentance, asceticism, and humility, St. Mary became a true mother of the desert, a hermit who, despite living away from the world, remained through prayer in communion with God and all creation. And although we're not all called to such a life of solitude and extreme asceticism, we too can be transformed by God's love and grace if we turn to Him in repentance. May we strive to emulate St. Mary's example of disposition of the heart as we continue to draw near to God, especially during the Lenten season. Saints Mary and Zosimus, servants of the true God, please pray for us.
Impressions?
I forgot to get the live story.
Yeah, it's a beautiful story. We're actually gonna, this coming Thursday, if you're free, this Thursday at Holy Trinity, at Holy Trinity this Thursday, we're gonna do the Canon of St. Andrew and split it up into parts and take breaks reading from the life of St. Mary. So feel free to come on by this Thursday at 6 p.m. To actually read from the text itself and be edified by that. Finally, we're gonna read this text here that's from an Orthodox website titled "How St. Mary of Egypt Guarded Her Five Senses and Reached Holiness." This is an article you can find at the link down below. And I found this a few years ago, and I thought it was a wonderful text to have and to read as we celebrate St. Mary. I will begin here, and then we'll go around. All right. "The fifth Sunday of Great Lent is marked with the memory of St. Mary of Egypt, the great sinner turned into a great saint. She found herself in the abyss of sin and ascended from there to the lofty height of virtue, where she could see the risen Christ in her heart. How did she manage to break free from the bonds of passions that she used to indulge herself in for so many years? How did she manage to achieve holiness? Let us find an answer in the teachings of Saint Nicodemus the Hierite on guarding the five senses, which he described in his book, A Handbook of Spiritual Counsel." That text is actually available for you in English if you're interested in reading that. All right, Tom, would you like to read this paragraph on guarding your sense of sight?
Guarding your sense of sight. St. Basil the Great teaches that our eyes are like two invisible hands that our souls use to touch things at a distance. That is why we should avert our eyes from physical beauty, which arouses our passion. King Solomon put it thus: Let your eyes look right on, and let your eyelids look straight before you. We've got to be very cautious because there are various images that make their imprints on our souls when we look at things, like thieves who get into people's houses through open windows. If the thief still manages to sneak inside the house of your soul, you should tackle the Aphrodite favorite passion of lust by calling upon God. Saint Nicodemus recommends driving lustful images away with spiritual images. And that was exactly what Saint Mary of Egypt did. When she tried to get into the church and venerate the Lord's cross, no sooner could she do it than when she realized that she was living in sin and saw an icon of the Theotokos. After looking at the spiritual image of the Mother of God, kissing the life-giving cross, and praying fervently, Mary made her first step towards liberation from the passions. Her eyes were healed for the first time. Mary went on to guard her eyes from worldly images for the rest of her life by recalling the icon of the Mother of God and by going into the desert where she didn't see anyone for 47 years.
Thank you. All right, CMLA, we skipped over you, so do you want to read the next section?
Guardian of sense of hearing. St. Nicodemus advises us to guard our ears from lewd songs because if your soul enjoys them, it remains insensitive to spiritual delights and is unable to see its miserable condition. Lewd songs also plant lustful images into your imagination, while your heart begins to bend towards accepting them. St. Nicodemus mentions Odyssey, who sealed his ears with wax so as not to hear the sirens' voices, as well as Xenocrates, an ancient Greek philosopher who taught young men to stick plugs into their ears so as not to hear lewd and inappropriate talk. Similarly, Mary of Egypt told Elder Zosimas, I was seized by an insane desire of dissolute songs, which was embarrassing because it enticed me to sing the demonic songs I had learned in the past. Mary would hit herself in the chest, bringing to mind her vows, reminding herself of the icon of the Mother of God and praying to the Most Pure Virgin to get rid of those thoughts. Upon crying for a long time, the light of grace would shine down on Mary and her passions calm down.
All right, George, let's come back to the start. Want to go next?
St. Nicodemus writes, you should guard your sense of smell from a appeasing odors and fragrances, because otherwise your soul will get too soft. Your mind will become devastated and more prone to insolence. Prophet Amos declares, woe to those who anoint themselves with cheap ointments. The great Isaiah seconds that, and it shall come to pass that instead of sweet smell, there shall be stink. St. Arsenius the Great never changed water in the bowl where he soaked palm branches. When asked why, he replied that it was his way of punishing himself for using too much sweet-smelling lotion while he was in the emperor's court. When Mary lived in sin back in Alexandria, she must have applied lotions and fragrances to her body to seduce as many men as possible. Probably the first time Mary had her sense of smell healed was a smell of frankincense in the church where the feast of the exaltation of the cross was being celebrated. She spent the rest of her life fragrance-free. She didn't smell anything but hot desert air. In the end of her life, she acquired an incorrupt transformation of her body by smelling the life-giving body of the Lord.
All right. Cody?
Guarding your sense of taste. Where do these lavish meals and refined food come from? Of course, they aren't necessary for the body. They appease the palate, St. Nicodemus writes. Appeasing your taste and eating too much are obstacles to piety, according to the scripture. But Jeshurun, waxed fat, and kicked, you are waxen fat. You have grown thick. You are covered with fatness. and he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. Apostle Paul, in his epistle to Philippians, admonishes those people whose God is their belly, and whose glory is their shame, whose mind is set on earthly things. St. Basil the Great recommends young people not to eat too much, because their blood is steaming hot already. If they eat heavy meal, their bodies will turn into Babylon furnaces. Mary of Egypt admitted to Elder Zosimus that she missed meat and fish, of which there were plenty in Egypt. She had liked wine and drunk it a lot. However, after she crossed the Jordan, she had 3 dry loaves for a long time, and when she finished them, she used plants and roots for food. Her biography also claims that after receiving Holy Communion, she accepted several grains of wheat from the elder as a sign of respect, but she refused any other food. She was illiterate and had never held a sacred book in her hands throughout her entire life. In spite of that, she knew the scripture well and could quote prophets and apostles, which shocked Elder Zosimus. That's how the Holy Spirit can invisibly feed hermits' souls with every word that comes out of God's mouth rather than bread.
Not a quick note, that reminds me of my patron saint, St. Sabas. He was in the desert during Great Lent. And during the 40 days, he didn't eat or drink anything. The only thing he took with him was Holy Communion. And that's what sustained him during the 40 days. Yeah. So, all right. You want to finish it up here, Garrett?
Yep. Regarding your sense of touch, St. Nicodemus writes that all senses are important, but even if the sin cannot sneak into a person's heart through the first 4 channels of perception, it uses the tactile sense as an easy way into the heart. The Holy Fathers recommend ascetics to be cautious, not only of touching other people, but also of touching their own bodies. St. Isaac instructs his readers, when nature calls you, do it with chastity, as if ashamed of the presence of your guardian angel. Do what you have to do with fear of God. It is our sense of touch that leads us to wear soft and comfortable clothes and sleep in a cozy bed. The Patericon tells a story of a brother who abstained from overeating, judgment, and everything else that incited the passion of lust, but he was attacked by the passion nevertheless. The elder finally went into the brother's cell and saw a soft bed. The elder exclaimed, "That's the reason for the lustful attacks you have, my brother." When Mary left for the desert, her ascetic living bolstered her ability to control the feeling through which she had faced the most harm. She slept on the ground. Her clothes decayed and worn off. She was roaming the desert naked and had to endure both cold and heat. St. Mary of Egypt is a remarkable example of repentance, unwavering desire to follow Christ, and of guarding herself against sin. You must run to win the race. Every Christian can and should be able to control his or her desires and feelings to fight tooth and nail for purity.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Well, that's a little overdoing it with that. Sleeping in a comfortable bed. I mean, come on. I mean, none of us are going to live like that. I mean, that's wonderful that this, I mean, I love her story and everything. But sometimes when you read these things, doesn't it make you think that they want us to be this this person that we can't, it's unattainable.
Well, we can't, we may not all be, I mean, you heard it in the video too. We may not all have the strength to sleep on the ground like an 80-year-old woman. Not everyone, no. I mean, there's, if you recall from our previous get-togethers when we talked about asceticism, right, is that there are specific ascetic practices or exercises that are curtailed according to which passion you struggle with. So St. Mary of Egypt struggled with lust, right? She was very attracted to physical pleasure. So as it says in the life of St. Joseph the Hesychast, he also struggled with lust, is that the sin, well, how do you say, the passion of pleasure, the passion of lust is cured with its opposite, pain. So you get rid of your inclination for seeking pleasure by basically undergoing painful ascetic exercises like sleeping on the ground, fasting, all-night vigils, right? The discomfort comes to subdue and control the passions. That's the point, right? And so, like I mentioned, is that specific ascetic practices are curtailed for each passion that we struggle with. And that's what St. John Climacus talks about in his text. For example, we heard about anger, right? What were some of the advice that he gave? He said, keep your mouth shut. Don't talk so much. Keep your thoughts to yourself. Don't focus on angry thoughts and judging people and all the rest, right? Get your mind off that stuff. So, but think about it in terms of medicine, right? And sickness. A person who has heart disease, you're not going to give them medication that a cancer patient needs, right? So no, not everyone has to sleep on the ground. Not everyone has to do 10 hours of nightly vigil, right? The spiritual father, and again, this goes back to the need of a spiritual father, right? Just with our physical health. We go to specialists, doctors, and all the rest who specialize in a particular area of health that we struggle with, and they will give us the appropriate medicine and advice necessary to overcome that sickness of ours. It works the same exact way in the spiritual life. We have spiritual diseases, our passions. And so we go to the spiritual father, and he's going to give us the appropriate spiritual medication, as it were, advice necessary to overcome the particular passions that we struggle with. So someone, let's say one person struggles with pride and another person struggles with lust. The spiritual father is going to look at the person with lust and say, okay, you need to emphasize and double down on fasting, nighttime vigil, prayer, controlling your intake of food and drink and what you struggle with in that capacity. But then look at the person who struggles with pride, and he's not going to say you need to do sleeping on the ground per se, or do night vigil. You need to practice silence more, or you need to do almsgiving more to be less selfish, that kind of a thing. And another thing, and we've looked at this in my book that I wrote, there's a chapter there where it talks about how you have to use common sense, okay, in your asceticism. So even St. John Climacus said this somewhere we heard tonight. You remember, he said, I didn't overdo it excessively with this or that, right? We have to use moderation and balance. So for example, I'll give you an example. An 80-year-old woman who can barely walk straight and so forth, she's not going to be able to sleep on the ground, right? Obviously, that's blessed. That's okay. We understand that, right? There's a pastoral condescension to her weakness. We understand that. And she might not be able to be a great faster, right? Can't fast from meat and dairy all the time because that'll ruin her health and put her in the hospital. And we say, okay, that's fine. We can find something else for you to help you in your spiritual life. So, no, not everyone has to sleep on the ground and do 10 hours of vigil and all the rest of these kinds of things. But again, it's curtailed according to your strengths and weaknesses and life circumstances as well. And again, that we need a spiritual father to kind of guide us through that. So, yeah.
I've heard this story several times, but I forgot about the line. You're going to have this on Thursday night as well?
This Thursday, we're going to actually read from the original text.
And then it'll be different than Sunday. We're going to do something.
It will be the Feast of St. Mary of Egypt, but we're not going to read from her life at church.
Is there a book of her life and her and Like how she lived her life for those 47 years?
Yeah. It would be in what we call the Synaxarion collection, the Lives of the Saints. It would be found in there. If you would like that, that handout, I can certainly send that your way.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's an unbelievable story.
Mm-hmm.
Even, I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, if I gave this story to one of my American friends, they'd think I'm whack.
Yeah.
You know?
It's beautiful. It's and I think the church places her at the end of basically the 40-day fast to remind us and to kind of give us a little bit of hope that even if you have failed greatly during the 40 days of Lent, maybe you didn't keep your fast as strictly as you did, or maybe you didn't really repent as much as you would have liked. We see in St. Mary is that, first off, that there's hope for everyone, you know. It doesn't matter how sinful, how evil you've become, you know, you can still repent and God will accept your repentance. You know, if you genuinely repent and are remorseful of your sin and you're trying to overcome that, God accepts that. You know, look at the thief on the cross, repented at the last moment before he took his last breath, and God placed him in paradise. So that's the awesomeness of our God, is that God is not some, you know, vengeful old man up in the sky ready to smite everyone down ready to just damn everyone. We have a very extremely, extremely loving, forgiving, merciful Father who accepts everyone who repents. And we see what great heights of, you know, it's amazing. You have this dichotomy, right? St. Mary was in the deepest of sin any person could possibly drown in. But then beautifully, she repented and she attained some of the greatest heights of holiness that a person could possibly achieve. I mean, it's amazing. Go from one extreme to the other. So it's a very hopeful story, a very inspiring story for all of us.
Is there a monastery built on her site?
I don't know. That's a good question. I don't know.
She had died the day he gave her communion, and her body was still intact.
A whole year later. I just realized that when I watched it. That's crazy. Like, perfectly intact. Like, boom, right there. And also the handwriting in the sand. Right?
Wow.
Yeah, you would think, like, the wind or whatever would have taken it away and everything. Amazing. Yeah.
I just can't get over she read. I mean, she knew the scripture so well, but had no books. It was all taught.
Yeah.
It's an amazing story.
Any other questions or comments?
Well, if it wasn't for that one father, she would have never known about.
Right.
Like her only connection to
the outside world. Yeah.
That's an interesting point.
Yeah.
I didn't really think of it.
And her story didn't get passed down. When he started passing the story down, it was just through oral tradition. It wasn't written down for a long time.
Oh.
So that's another miracle of her life, you know, that's been perfectly preserved in great detail.
And wasn't there another story where Jesus Christ came amongst the prostitute? They were throwing rocks, and that was another person, of course. But
yeah.
Wasn't that a... And she
yeah.
repented and...
Yeah, she committed adultery.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he said, who have you... Well, how was it?
Those who have not, like, sinned, cast a person.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Be a hypocrite.
Right.
That was during his 3 years of ministry.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have glass houses back then.
I've been doing, showing pictures of my pilgrimage to the Holy Lands, recently. And for you guys, there are freebies, free things I brought from the Holy Lands. Please take as much as you want. It's for you guys. Check that out on your way there. This icon, beautiful icon that was made recently in the last few years by Legacy Icons. shows all the saints that we commemorate throughout the weeks of Great Lent. You can check that out. Here's the text. You can check that out. The other text, you can check that out. Otherwise, I will see you next Tuesday. Let's talk about Holy Week. Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Good videos. Good videos.